Welcome back to Google Developers Live at I.O. I'm Lewis Gray, broadcasting here from the Moscone Center in San Francisco. I have not one, but two distinguished guests with us today to talk about Google Plus SignIn. We have a Director of Product, Seth Sternberg, as well as Director of Engineering, David Glazer, from the Google Plus project. So thank you both for coming in.
Thanks for having us. Appreciate it.
Thank you. So this has actually been a really incredible conference, you know, with 3.5-hour keynote, full of content back to back to back. We just had a really solid discussion with Bradley Horowitz about the three major pieces of Google Plus that were introduced yesterday, talking through the stream design, the Hangouts application, and all the Photos experience.
That's right.
And very recently, we introduced Google Plus SignIn.
That's right.
This is kind of your baby. And so we definitely want to talk to the developers, the many thousands of developers who are watching on the live stream and those who will watch after the fact. We wanted to talk about Google Plus SignIn and say what it is and how it's impacting developers. So maybe we could start with that at the very beginning. You can tell us a little bit about Google Plus SignIn, what it does, and how you guys arrived at delivering the product as it is today.
So I think the best way to understand Google Plus SignIn is to start by understanding what problem we were trying to help developers and users solve. And the problem was, we think there's an opportunity to make everything users do online better by bringing the power of Google with you when you go to the apps and sites that you use. And at the same time, take what you're doing in those apps and bring it back to Google to make the whole experience better for everyone. So in that context, what Google Plus SignIn does is very simple. It allows you to form a connection between who you are on Google, your Google Plus identity, and who you are in the apps and sites that you use. So I go to a website, say OpenTable.com, and I can sign in using my Google identity. OpenTable now gets some information about me from Google and has access to other Google services. And OpenTable has the ability to send information about what I'm doing back to me at Google.
Now, what kind of information is that? I mean, if I'm going to sign in with my Google Plus SignIn on OpenTable or any, I guess you got like 50 plus partners here in the sandbox. If I'm signing in to Google Plus on any of these apps, what information is being shared? And does the user know what the application is asking for?
Yeah, so the user, pivoting to the second part, yes, the user absolutely knows what's being asked for. That was one of the responsibilities that we took very seriously in building Google Plus SignIn. We heard from users we talked to that they trusted Google and that they were inclined to like the idea of signing in with Google because they knew that Google was a trusted place to do that and would do right by them. Mm-hmm. That added a big responsibility to us to live up to that responsibility, to continue to earn and increase that trust. The first part of that is making sure users know exactly what is happening. So specifically, when you sign in with Google, you see the big red sign in with Google, you click it, you get a consent dialog. It's the same dialog wherever you're signing in. It says OpenTable, sticking with the example, would like to. And then there's two things. One is, what information are you giving permission for Google to send to OpenTable? And it's your name, mm-hmm. your profile picture, and whatever public information you have put out on your Google Plus profile.
And you say public. I mean, one of the interesting things about Google Plus is you have that ability to share privately. You know, circles have been something from Google Plus from the very beginning.
Yep.
So with SignIn, we're definitely making sure that only the content that you share publicly, the information about you, that that's what's being sent to the app, should they choose to look at that. Is that right?
And then the one other thing that the app gets under the user's control is the list of people in your circles. Not the list of your circles, because we think that how you choose to organize your relationships
is your
business.
That's up to you, and that's private.
That's right. But it's very useful in many applications. You can have a better experience if you are, if you're looking for a movie to watch, knowing what other people that you care about, what they're doing around movies. If you're looking for news to read, knowing what the other people you know, what news they're reading. There's a lot of ways that developers can build a better experience if they know who you are connected to. So we also give the app that information about who are your...
Now, Seth, we were talking before we broadcast about the 50-plus partners we have in the sandbox. And we just launched Google Plus SignIn, or Google SignIn, about 2 months ago. I mean, so what is it, how did we go about getting these initial partners, and what is it they're finding really exciting about bringing SignIn with Google to their apps?
That's a great question. So, as you point out, this is only a 2-month-old product, right? So we're very new in market. We had 10 great launch partners. So we actually recently went back to them and asked, like, hey, what have you experienced? Tell us. We heard from the fancy that Google Plus sign-in is outperforming every other social login on their system. Users are more engaged with it than any other one.
And what does that mean? I mean, you say outperforming or engaging. Does that mean more people are using
more
it
more people
total?
Are signing in, better conversion. The Guardian, they told us that on Android, Google Plus sign-in is the number one sign-in option, with 41% of the users choosing Google Plus sign-in. Then Skill Pages, who just launched 3 weeks ago, right? So they're new, they were not an original launch partner. 3 weeks ago, Skill Pages puts Google Plus sign-in out. 2 nights ago, they told us that we are now 50% of all social login. So what's happening is users, when they have the option to use Google Plus to sign in, are choosing Google Plus in really big numbers because they trust it. Right, they understand that it'll enable them to do great things, to share with their friends when they want to, or to get really easily download an Android app, or to bring their the best of their Google experience with them to the rest of the internet. But it won't spam their friends.
Right,
it's a safe option for Google for users, excuse me, and it's great for developers because they still have really powerful ways to write information about what that user's done in their apps back to Google and then get more traffic back.
Sure.
Now you pointed out. 54. We have 54 developers here in the sandbox on display, and of course many, many more than that that have now launched Google Plus sign-in. So we're so happy at the uptake that we've seen, both with users, and as witnessed by the Fancy and Guardian and Skill Pages, and with developers choosing to integrate.
And we saw some of those actually earlier today. One of our first things that we did this morning was highlight a number of partners from the Google Plus sandbox. Daniel Seberg went through, and we rolled some of that video this morning.
Great.
I've seen a number of media partners who are here. You know, people like The Verge and SB Nation, Mashable. What is it about media that makes sense to have a sign-in with Google Plus? Why is that one of the first places that's really taking off?
Sure. So, you know, when you're reading through or a story or watching a video, oftentimes you really want your friends or colleagues to participate in that with you too. So one feature that we built is it's very easy for a publisher to click, send to my friends or, watch with friends. In that post, when a user is signed in, or the user clicks the post and then they'll be asked to sign in order to send it, that's what we call an interactive post. And it has a button on it, it's a clear call to action. So like for a video, watch. And when your friend gets that, and they'll get it across all of Google properties, right? The notifier will light up on search and on YouTube and in Maps and in Google Plus, on Android, it'll light up everywhere. When your friend gets it, and they click that watch button or they click that read button, they're taken right to that article or that video in the mobile app, in the desktop web, wherever the user may be. If they don't have the app, they'll be asked if they want to download the app, right? So it's a way to get your friends involved with you in consuming media. And hey, in the real world, we consume media with our friends all
the time.
Now, at the same time, what the developer gets out of this is not just a share that had a very clear call to action, but if that user has an Android device and does not have your Android app, the user will be asked if they want to install your Android app on your website. Right, so you're on that machine, on a web, website, you connect using Google Plus, and it says, hey, do you want, the Guardian's Android app? And we're doing this because if you're making a connection with the Guardian, then you probably would really want their app. And of course, we only ask if you don't yet have it.
Right.
And,
and we know that thanks to the integration. I mean, one of the things that
That's
we talked about with Bradley is you see two things happening. One, with Google Plus being some of that social layer, you have that ability to understand who the person is, and
That's
it ties into Google Play, and you know what's on their Android
That's
device. And you also have that option to take that next step of activity.
That's
and you have the unification of desktop and mobile.
That's right.
So one of the big things with the design of Google Plus that was just redone, but you have that kind of getting from the desktop to the mobile experience should be the same.
That's right.
And that's been something that's been echoed repeatedly.
That's
now you were talking about the percentage of installs.
So yeah, so powerful is not only do we give this offer to users, 40% of users who are asked if they want your Android app say yes. That is incredible, right? If you think about lots of developers are purchasing ads to get Android app installs or iOS installs, maybe they get 1% who say yes. This is 40 times that.
Right.
40% of users say yes, I want the app. And then even better, just announced yesterday, is when the user then picks up their tablet or picks up their mobile phone and taps on your chiclet, right? You are already logged in. So if you've connected on web, you're automatically connected on mobile, And vice versa.
Because it knows you've already done it one time.
That's right.
Why go through the process
That's
a second
right.
time?
Unbelievably seamless experience for users. And for developers, they can give users a much better experience, right? Because now you've got your account, you have your shopping cart, you have your preferences, stories you've bookmarked, your friends. All of that is just now available across devices.
Now, speaking of getting started on some of this stuff, how did developers start with Google Plus sign-in? Like, where are they supposed to go? We've got 50-plus people here today. I'm hoping next year we have more than that or some incredible stories.
It'll be hard. We'll run out of space.
Moscone just for G Plus sign-in.
How's
that?
There you
go. So how do people get started with Google Plus sign-in?
So go to developers.google.com/plus,
uh-huh. and that's the top of the tree, and that'll get you there. What you'll find there are samples. You'll find a quick start, you'll find full reference documentation, you'll find a recap of the features and benefits. But I can do the quick version of the quick start right here. If you have a website, you want to put a sign in with Google button on your website, you do two things. The first thing you do is you put a line of JavaScript on your website. If you're using the plus one button, you already have the line of JavaScript. It's already there. And the second thing is you put in a little bit of markup that says G:\signin button, mm-hmm. and then provide the parameters that we need. That's all you do to your website. You then have to do some work on your back end to take advantage of users being signed in, right? You have to know they're signed in. You have to say, hello, Lewis, when they are signed in. You have to do whatever other capabilities you want to add. But the basics of just getting a hello world alive on your site is as simple as I said.
Right, just at developers.google.com/plus. Now, as someone who's been running Google Developers Live events yep. for practically a year now, we regularly have the Google Plus development team, the Google Plus platform team, coming in and doing office hours, yep. showcasing partners, talking about features. I know, Seth, you've joined us a couple of times on that, so mm-hmm. I appreciate that. And obviously, one of the things we really want to have people understand is that they can connect with you both, mm-hmm. and myself as well, using Google Developers Live through the rest of the year. So you go to developers.google.com/plus for all the great Google Plus sign-in. And when you're done, you go back to developers.google.com/live to watch the kind of engagement that we're having here year-round. And so I definitely appreciate you guys coming and meeting with me at GDL.io at Moscone. I think it's a really special event, really important for us to talk directly to developers like we're doing. And for those of you who want to be seeing this kind of content every single day, go to youtube.com, look for Google Developers, and subscribe. Up next at GDL.io, we'll be back at 1:35 to talk about maps and walk through the map sandbox. But until then, we'll return you back to your live sessions. Thank you.
Thanks for having us.